Hello and welcome to the Daily Roundup. I am Sumedha.
And I am Probir. We'll take a look at the top stories of the day.
For our top story today, we're giving you a heads up on the third phase of the elections tomorrow. There are 12 states, 2 union territories, and now 117 parliamentary constituencies going to polls tomorrow. The key states being Gujarat with 26 seats, Kerala with 20, Uttar Pradesh with 10, Bengal with 4, and Bihar with 5 seats. Today, the Election Commission has also announced that Tripura East is going to go to polls tomorrow. In 2014, the BJP and its allies had bagged about 67 seats, while the Congress and its allies managed to get about 26 seats and the others getting about 23. Tomorrow is a very significant day for the state of Kerala as well, because polling is taking place in the entire state tomorrow for 20 seats. And Prabir, so Kerala is going to polls, and we did some analytics here as well at NewsClick. So tell us a bit about that, and how do you see the polls in Kerala panning out?
You see, this has always been a difficult state to predict, because Kerala, the margins have always been low. So even if a particular party wins and sweeps the state, the number of votes it secures is not significantly different than the other side. Maybe a 3% swing is a decisive seat in terms of seats. So this, I will say, is therefore not an easy state to predict. It does appear at the moment that the LDF, led by the CPM, has a clear edge, partly because of the assembly elections last time. If you translate that to current number of seats, it really has a almost, you know, sweep of the state. 15 seats against 5 of the Congress, that's what it would emerge. But this time it's more difficult to predict, partly because of the Sabarimala issue.
Yes.
I think Pinarayi Vijayan had done very well. He had handled the floods, therefore there was a lot of appreciation the way the government functioned at a difficult time. But the Sabarimala agitation against the Supreme Court judgment has created certain fissures, particularly among conservative sections. So we'll have to see how that pans out. Though it is a BJP-led alliance, the Congress also supported it.
Yeah.
And therefore, when it comes to votes, will they actually vote for the BJP or vote for the Congress? We'll have to see, because they know BJP, apart from Trivandrum, is not a strong contender anywhere. The other part of it, and I think this is also something we have to take into account, Rahul Gandhi's entry into Kerala. What does it do to the Congress? Does it help its fortunes? I think what it does is paper over the internal fight, which the Chennithala section versus Oman Chandi section have been having. But having said that, I don't think electorally it's going to make that much of a difference in Kerala. So apart from Wayanad, where Rahul Gandhi may win, but I don't think he's going to make an dent into the state. So his election is not, his entry in Kerala is not going to really significantly affect the voting results. But yes, it does help Congress paper over some differences.
And we're also looking at Uttar Pradesh, apart from Kerala, where 10 seats are going to polls tomorrow. And among these 10, 7 seats were held by the BJP and 3 were held by the Samajwadi Party the last time. So there has been a certain projection that we've done for UP as well. And there are some key issues, Prabir, that are going to come up, cow vigilantism being one. And the effect of Mahagathbandhan, how do you see that?
I think it's very clear that arithmetic is clearly in favor of the Gathbandhan. The SP, yeah. BSP votes, if you just simply arithmetically add up, BJP does not so well, or does fairly badly in these seats, in these elections. So I think that's a clear no-brainer, that if the SP, BSP's votes do hold, that they're going to come out on top in these seats. The question is, what is the Congress role going to be? How much votes it can actually split? In certain seats, it has the capacity to split votes, but not significantly in most of the state. The last part of it is the cow vigilantism you talked about. The more important part is what it is now proving to be, that there's a huge cow menace, stray cows destroying fields, and it really causing the farmers sleepless nights, destruction of their crops and so on. And I think that's going to prove heavy for the BJP. There is farmers' anger in any case. On top of that, you have the cow menace.
So there are other very important constituencies which are going to polls tomorrow. There is one seat on which polling is taking place in Kashmir, which is the militancy hit Anantnag as well. And that's where former Chief Minister Mehbooba Mufti is also contesting her election. Also in the fray tomorrow is going to be Amit Shah, who is the BJP president, and he's contesting from Gandhinagar as well. So we're going to, you know, catch up on how their nominations, how their victories are going to look like, if they win, what is going to be the case for Kerala and also Uttar Pradesh. For our other big story, we're looking at the nomination of Pragya Thakur. So she is an accused, as we've been saying on the Daily Roundup, we've been following her story. So today she's finally managed to also file her nomination without any problem whatsoever. And there has not been a word on her case from the NIA court hearing, which was supposed to take place today. The father of the Maligaon bomb blast victim had moved the special NIA court, urging it to bar the prime accused Pragya Thakur from contesting the Lok Sabha polls after the BJP had given her a ticket. And Prabir, we've been recently seeing that there is a lot of defense of her induction. Amit Shah has also gone on to defend her. So what has he said in his speech? And also yesterday as well, she'd said that she's very proud of the Babri demolition as well.
Well, she has said more than that. She has said she was a participant in the Babri demolition. She would have been, according to the affidavit, she would have been probably at the age of 4 or so at the time of the Babri demolition. So, very difficult to understand what she's really saying.
Yeah.
Part of also her giving shrap and killing people through her curses and so on. So, those are questions which are hanging over how she conducts herself, shall we say. But I think Amit Shah's statement is more important because he basically says what BJP has been asserting all the time, that any Hindu by definition is not a terrorist. Any Muslim who is accused by definition is a terrorist. And therefore, Maligaon blast, in spite of all the evidence of conspiracy, the NIA's weakening of the case, which it was asked to, we have Rohini Salwan's statement on that count, we should therefore regard the Hindu accused as non-terrorists because they can't be, while the Muslims by definition should be always considered terrorists irrespective of the evidence against them. And he reiterated that again. It's the essential issue that we have before us is that BJP in this particular case has launched an attack on the Muslims, identifying Muslims with Pakistan, using Pakistan as really a via media to attack the Indian Muslims. And that's the significant part of this election. And Pragya Thakur's big nomination and campaigning is all going to be part of that.
And for our other big story, we've been following sexual harassment charges against Chief Justice of India, Ranjan Gogoi, as well. So there is a statement that has come out on Saturday evening. The Women in Criminal Law Association, which is a collaborative group for women in criminal litigation, they have issued a very strongly worded statement against the CJI and the handling of the sexual harassment charges which have been leveled against him by a former junior court assistant. So the statement raises very strong questions about him being the chair of his own hearing, about not having a woman on the panel when the hearing was taking place. A lot of other collective condemnation is coming forth, and there are questions being raised about the judicial system as well.
Yeah, I think we should talk about what the case content is, because that's not what is being discussed right now. It's a conduct of the Chief Justice once accusations have been leveled against him, and how he should have handled it, and the fact what we mentioned yesterday, that there is a committee to look into sexual harassment, which wasn't convened, instead of which a bench was constituted, and Chief Justice sitting on the bench. This is what I think is the basic issue, which has now roiled the judicial as well as the legal circuits.
And also moving on to a big international development that had taken place yesterday, Sri Lanka has witnessed the worst kind of violence to have actually hit the island nation since the civil war that had ended a decade ago. Yesterday, which was Easter morning, there have been about 8 blasts and also targeting the churches as well as some international hotels as well. 5-star hotels were also targeted, and about 300 people have already died due to the attacks. There have been about 500 and more people who've been injured as a consequence of these attacks. And now there are, you know, different kind of reports coming in as to who is responsible for these attacks, and a national emergency has also been declared in Sri Lanka until yesterday. From yesterday they've been in a curfew, and now there's a national emergency.
Well, very unfortunate, of course, the civilian deaths on such a large scale. It also indicates that terrorism again has no religion. Absolutely. In the case of New Zealand, it was a white supremacist who was a Christian attacking a mosque. In this particular case, we don't know. We have unnamed, unidentified, shall we say, people who have blown themselves up as well. It seems to be having a terror bombing, and which has killed such a large number of people. So this is certainly a setback for Sri Lanka, partly because they've come out of, as you said, a 10-year long civil war. And this could again create fractures within the Sri Lankan society. And so I think that's something we have to really now be very concerned about. I think there are two other issues which are important. One is the fact that the churches were never attacked. Neither were religious places attacked earlier.
Yeah.
The Sri Lankan Tamil Tigers attacked the government, of course attacked civilians, government facilities and so on. And it was still a case of civil war of a certain kind, in which bomb blast, suicide bombing was used. This is against people. So I think this is qualitatively different from what the earlier civil war was really all about. And I think therefore this is rather, shall we say, unhappy portents for the island nation.
So we will be following that story as we go ahead on the Daily Roundup as well from now on. And to look at our stories that we've done on the elections, on Pragya Thakur, and also on the sexual harassment case against Chief Justice, please go to our website www.newsclick.in. Subscribe to our channel on YouTube. Follow us on Facebook.